Welcome back to Tilling the Soil. I'm your host, Mr. Jason. Thank you for joining me once again, and I'd love to see you showed up to view this week's installment. So you can type the names of those watching in the comments below. And at the end, I'd love to read your answers to Pastor Kevin's question from kids segment. And to give you an idea of what we'll be studying from in tonight's program, we're going to be going through parts of Psalm 2, Luke 4, and James chapter 1. But first things first, before we begin in the program, let's go in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to gather like this again, to gather as our Monday night digital small group, to gather together in the comments section and just to look at your word, to see what you have for us here tonight, to help us grow closer to you, to grow stronger in you, and to find out how to best live out our lives as citizens in your kingdom, Lord. So please help us to open up our hearts to you tonight, to expand our minds around your word, and to just learn to grow closer to you as we sit here and study your scripture. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. And with that, it's the Bible verse. So I'll say the verse, and then you can repeat after me. Now, without faith, it is impossible to please God. Since the one who draws near to him must believe that he exists, and that he rewards those who seek him. Hebrews 11:6. As I mentioned last week, we'll be going through Hebrews 11 a little bit more in depth in a few weeks. So for a quick breakdown of this verse again, the unknown author of Hebrews is speaking here of the most basic form of faith, that infantile faith that causes people to look up and seek God, like a baby looking up to find their parents, not really able to comprehend anything that's going on around them, but they know what they're looking for. So the author is saying that in order to even have that much faith, someone would have to believe that God exists. They would have to believe that much at least to even bother looking for God in the first place. Now, in order to please the Lord with that faith, though, we have to go a little bit further than that, and we must believe God rewards those who diligently seek his face, and we must trust in him to provide for us, to provide for his children as a loving father does. And for tonight's verse lesson, I want to continue to cover the psalm we began last week, the one having to deal with this idea, a psalm that speaks to the ultimate thing the Lord provided for us, the Messiah. So let's begin our study tonight by continuing from where we left off last week, in Psalm 2, verses 4 through 6. But the one who rules in heaven laughs, the Lord scoffs at them. If we remember back to our first three verses from last week, the nations were raging against the chains of God, the chains of morality and goodness that convict the unrepentant of the sinfulness they're living their lives in. The nations are plotting against the anointed of God, against the kingship of the returned Christ. But as they rage and plot and plan, the Lord doesn't worry. The Father doesn't begin analyzing how to defend himself from those coming against him. The Father laughs, scoffs at those nations trying to rise up against him. He holds them in derision, as the New King James says. He laughs at them mockingly. I recently showed my children a video from some years ago of a British comedian named Stephen Fry. And he was giving an interview where he was asked about what if the God that he mocks and denies is actually real. And Stephen Fry said that he'd hold God to account for all the cruelty and injustice that God created in the world, that he'd demand answers and explanations from God if God was real and he had seen him. And that even if he could, he wouldn't even want to live in heaven for eternity with such an evil God. That he wouldn't want to live in heaven if it meant living by God's terms, under God's rules. And that's what it always comes down to with unbelievers. Always. An unwillingness to turn away from their sinfulness and turn to something better. This desire to untether themselves from God by tethering themselves to sin instead. So they blind themselves to the sin that they've welcomed into their lives and embraced in their lives by instead shifting the blame for that sinfulness on God. They blame the cruelty of man's fallen nature on God. They blame the injustice of man's wicked hearts on God. And because their sinfulness never brings them any lasting form of happiness, because happiness is simply a fleeting human emotion, the unbelievers like Stephen Fry mock God. But see, since they don't actually believe God exists, they're actually mocking God as a way to mock us, to mock Christians, to embarrass us Christians for finding joy in the smallest of blessings, to make us feel ashamed for finding joy in something they see as insignificant, or even in some cases selfish. Now see, I find great joy in dropping my kids off at school every morning, specifically in that 5 to 10 seconds where I pick each of them up and give them a hug. To people who can't find joy in the simplest of things, they'd never be able to understand how that combined maybe a minute and a half a week of joy can outweigh the many minutes of frustration I experience at having to discipline and lecture and scold my kids a week for silly nonsense that they honestly should know better than to do, because that's the way kids are. But it's because those people who don't find joy in simple blessings, those that don't believe, they just don't understand the enduring love of the Father like we Christians do. So they can't find the joy in the small stuff. And that's why, as much as those living in unrepentant sin wish to mock and attack and shame and rage against God, he sits calmly in heaven, chuckling and patiently waiting in his enduring love for all to come to faith in his anointed one, that will come to faith in his anointed one. Because one day, his perfect judgment will come. And the time for laughing will be over. And the time for heartbreak will begin. Both for those who chose to reject the hand of salvation offered to them by the Father, and for the Father himself, the one who wishes for none to perish and be separated from him for eternity. Then, in anger, he rebukes them, terrifying them with his fierce fury. In verse 5 here, we see an example of God's enduring love for his wayward creation. Now, you may ask how God rebuking the nations in anger is loving. But we have to consider what God could have done to those who test him, who taunt him, who plot violence against him. God could have simply destroyed all involved, but he didn't. Instead, he raised his voice a little. He granted them a warning to turn away from their prideful, sinful ways and return to a right relationship with him. Sadly, though, his warning caused them fright. It scared them, but they ultimately wouldn't turn from the sinfulness they'd placed before him. Or placed ahead of him. For the Lord declares, I have placed my chosen king on the throne in Jerusalem, on my holy mountain. Studying for the psalm, I came across a quote from Charles Spurgeon. God's anointed is appointed and shall not be disappointed. Now, I'm a sucker for lines like that, but this is the Lord's rebuke to the nation. That the Father has placed his chosen king, God the Son, on the throne in Jerusalem to rule over all things, as he once did before the time of the kings, back when people placed their faith and trust in God to be their king. During that time of judges, the people stumbled and strayed off the path, and each time the Lord raised a judge and provided for the people, because he was their king. And here in this verse, God is telling the nations that once again, he will be their king, that he will take up his throne on his holy mountain. And nothing anyone says or does will change that. Because the time of man's fallen nature ruling their hearts and the lies and temptations of the enemy ruling their lands was coming to an end. God's appointed, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, God himself, is appointed, is chosen, is being placed by God in his role, and shall not be disappointed. And no one can take that from him. And no one can alter the plan of God and his kingship over mankind. His judgment over all mankind won't be a disappointment, because the new king, the chosen king, the king of kings, was going to be someone of perfect justice and perfect love, was going to be perfection itself. So, how about we get loosened up a bit before we head into the main Bible video by listening and moving along with our Bible verse song, along with Miss Bella. And now, since everyone's loose, let's get to this week's Bible video.
Jesus traveled to Capernaum with his disciples Simon, Andrew, James, and John. He went into the synagogue on the Sabbath and began to teach. The people there were very surprised at his teaching. Jesus' teaching was not like the scribes' teaching. He spoke with authority. Just then, a man with an unclean spirit shouted, "What do you have to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." Jesus commanded the spirit to be quiet and to come out of the man. The spirit yelled again and then came out. Everyone was amazed. "Who is this Jesus?" they asked. "He teaches with authority, and the unclean spirits obey him." News about Jesus spread quickly throughout all of Galilee. Next, Jesus and his disciples went to Simon and Andrew's house. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever. Jesus went to her, took her hand, and healed her. She got up and began to serve them. That evening, large crowds of people came to the house with others who were sick or bothered by evil spirits, and Jesus healed them. Early the next morning, Jesus went out by himself to pray. Simon and the other disciples found him and said, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus said, "Let's go on to the nearby villages so that I can preach there too. This is why I have come." Jesus' miracles proved that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. His miracles strengthened people's faith and met their needs. Through Jesus, God did what is impossible for us to do on our own. He provided forgiveness, salvation, and eternal life.
This week's Bible video covers the miracles Jesus performed during his time in Capernaum after being rejected by the people of his hometown of Nazareth. So, for tonight's lesson, let's begin right where we left off last week, in Luke chapter 4, verses 31 through 44. Then Jesus went to Capernaum, a town in Galilee, and taught there in the synagogue every Sabbath day. So following the people of Nazareth becoming enraged at Jesus during his teaching in the synagogue where Jesus told them that the promised time of the Messiah had come, Jesus returns to the town of Capernaum, the city of comfort. And this is the city or town where Jesus would spend most of his ministry, teaching, as this verse records, in the synagogue every Sabbath and performing miracles like we will read about in a bit. There, too, the people were amazed at his teachings, for he spoke with authority. You know, as with the people of Nazareth, and really people everywhere Jesus taught, the people of Capernaum were amazed at the teachings of Christ, amazed with the authority he spoke with, amazed at the wisdom that he was able to convey through his teachings. I'm sure there were, like there are today, priests and teachers who spoke with a high level of confidence, who spoke eloquently, who spoke incredibly well, spoke in a way that kept the attention of their audience. And Jesus may have done these same things, but that's not what caught the attention of those who heard Jesus speak. It was the authority in which he spoke. The authority that Jesus spoke with that made those hearing him understand that he wasn't just speaking about the Word of God, but that he had a command of the Word of God, which he did, seeing as he is the Word of God. Once when he was in the synagogue, a man possessed by a demon, an evil spirit, cried out shouting. Now, one of these times that Jesus was in the synagogue teaching, a man possessed by a demon cried out and began shouting. And you know, I'm actually kind of happy that the curriculum doesn't shy away from this topic. This topic of demon possession and spiritual warfare. Because I feel like this is one of those things that the majority of Christians will admit to understanding as a reality in our world. To it, each other, at least. But I feel like far too many Christians would rather avoid speaking about publicly. Like admitting in public in front of the secular, unbelieving world that spiritual warfare is very, very real. And something to be taught and understood as that is a source of embarrassment for them almost, for some of these Christians. Like, I see so many Christians almost act like they're embarrassed to admit that the flood of Noah is a real event, or that everything was created by God in six literal days, which, be honest, is something I myself struggle with, having been an unbeliever for so long. But demon possession, being possessed by an evil spirit, is very real. And we see it all the time in our world today. People inexplicably carrying out tragedies of great evil. And everyone asks why, but refuse to see the answer for what it is. A person possessed by an evil spirit. There's one thing to remember for believers, though. for those who truly follow Christ. We can be tempted by evil spirits. We can be tricked, but we can never, never be possessed by an evil spirit. Because if we truly follow Christ, then we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit doesn't dwell in a part of us. He fills us. And he doesn't share his space. So once we have the Spirit dwelling in us, there is no room for an evil spirit. And no evil spirit can remove the Holy Spirit from us. No evil spirit is going to kick the Holy Spirit out of his dwelling place. Go away. Why are you interfering with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. Now, you may ask what prompted this outburst from the demon. After all, what was Jesus doing to interfere with demons? What had Jesus done to show that he had come to destroy demons? Well, we have to remember that the devil knows Scripture far better than we do. And Satan knew better than the Pharisees and the high priests of the Sanhedrin what the prophecies of the Old Testament prophets meant, what the coming of the Messiah meant. The devil and his demons knew that their time of having power over the children of God was coming to an end with the arrival of the Messiah. And they were not happy about it. But Jesus reprimanded him. "Be quiet, come out of the man," he ordered. At that, the demon threw the man to the floor as the crowd watched. Then it came out of him without hurting him further. "Be quiet, come out of the man." No theatrics, no rituals, no chanting, just a command. See, one of the reasons I believe Christians like to avoid the topic of spiritual warfare generally and demon possession more specifically is that we live in a time where attention is the food people live on. Much like Jesus told his disciples that he had a kind of food they knew nothing about, doing God's will. Well, people today have a food that we know way too much about. An addiction of sorts, an addiction to being the center of attention at all times. We live in a time when everything must be recorded and photographed and posted to social media, or else it's like it didn't happen. And that doesn't just extend to the secular, unbelieving world, but also to the Christian one. Though I use that term loosely, because I'm not sure these people I'm about to mention can be classified as Christians at all. Not people who post stuff, but these people I'm about to mention. Because the fruit they bear isn't the fruit of God, but the bitter, rotten fruit of deception. See, we live in a time of the social media foe, the fake faith healers, and yes, exorcists. Those who claim to battle and cast out demons from those in their congregations. But remember one thing that we've already talked about. A Christian can't be possessed. So if one of this exorcist's supposed congregants is claiming to have a demon inside of them, well, then that congregant is kind of admitting that they're not really a Christian to begin with, because a Christian can't have a demon possessing them. So we can already see how the charade is unraveling here. But there's one other reason these supposed exorcists are lying and deceiving, and that reason is found in those seven words I began with. "Be quiet, come out of the man." See, in these videos of exorcists casting out demons, the exorcists are always asking questions of the demons and probing to find out the motivation of why the demon is possessing the person, the demon's history, why it picked that person, why it does this, what are its powers. Like the exorcist is interviewing the demon for its biography. But that's not how Jesus handled it here. Jesus didn't care that what the demon had to say. He wanted nothing to do with what it had to say. After all, demons are liars. Why would they be honest? And why trust anything they had to say? And why would somebody want the crowd around them to hear the lies of the demon and possibly be influenced by them? Now, there is one instance in Mark where Jesus is questioning a demon. But see, in that instance, there wasn't a crowd around to hear what the demon answered him. We need to be very careful to be discerning about what media, be it TV or radio or books, or really any information we allow ourselves to consume, that we allow ourselves to take in, so that we don't allow anything false to take root in our minds that hardens our hearts to truth. Because we live in a world where everyone takes Shakespeare's "The World is a Stage" to heart, where everything has to be performative and act. But we aren't to be performative, so the eyes of the world fall on us. We're just to be humbly going about the Father's work, spreading His word. And the only way to fight off that temptation for attention is to practice humility in our lives. Amazed, the people exclaimed, "What authority and power this man's words possess! Even evil spirits obey him, and they flee at his command." The news about Jesus spread through every village in the entire region. The Pharisees were thought to be able to cast out demons themselves. Whether they could or not, I have no idea. But even those Pharisees thought to be able to do so, those Pharisees needed rituals and chants and tools, but not Christ. All he needed was words, because his words carried the authority of God, since he is the Word, the one through which everything was made and all of creation answers to. And yes, even demons answer to him, because demons were created by God. Now, they were created as angels before they turned and fell, but they were created originally by God. After leaving the synagogue that day, Jesus went to Simon's house, where he found Simon's mother-in-law very sick with a high fever. "Please heal her," everyone begged. If we recall, Simon here is Simon Peter, the brother of Andrew and one of the central figures of the church to be built in Christ's name. And as we spoke about last week, Jesus and a few of his eventual disciples, like Simon Peter, did know each other, or at least were familiar with each other, before he officially called them to leave their lives behind and follow him in his ministry. Which helps us to understand a little better the timeline of the gospel accounts. How and why different accounts list events with Jesus and some of his disciples together, seemingly before Jesus officially calls his disciples to him. And one major thing we need to remember and keep in mind as we go through the Gospels, it's that they aren't meant to fit together neatly like a puzzle, which frustrates me to no end because I am the type of person who is constantly trying to fit the Gospels together and trying to work out how and why each author added what they did, where they did. We just need to remember, me specifically, by the way, that the Gospels were written for different audiences and for different reasons, but with one ultimate purpose: to spread the good news of salvation in Christ to everyone in the world. There's a harmony to the Gospels, but they aren't really a puzzle to be assembled. Standing at her bedside, he rebuked the fever and it left her, and she got up at once and prepared a meal for them. So Jesus comes to the home of Simon Peter and finds Peter's mother-in-law very sick and bedridden, feverish, and with everyone begging him to heal her as he had done to others. And when Jesus stands at her bedside, he does something a little odd, a little different than we read about before. Jesus rebukes the fever, he scolds the fever, and the fever leaves her. Which leaves us with a bit of an unanswered question of what does that mean? Was the fever also part of a spiritual attack that seems to be running rampant through this town at the time? Or just the way he handled this particular sickness? Now, I'm not smart enough to even attempt to answer all that. But what we do know is that Peter's mother-in-law didn't slowly recover as we're used to seeing someone when they're getting over a sickness, but that she got up at once. She was immediately and miraculously healed as if she'd never been sick, and began preparing a meal for her guests. As the sun went down that evening, people throughout the village brought sick family members to Jesus, No matter what their diseases were, the touch of his hand healed everyone. The sun going down here is actually an important detail because it meant that the Sabbath was over, because the Jewish people counted their days from sundown to sundown and not sun up as we kind of do. And with the Sabbath over, the restrictions on the lives of the Jewish people were lifted and the people began coming to Jesus to seek the healing of Simon, the healing that Simon Peter's mother-in-law actually had just received. And Jesus, the living embodiment of God's perfect love, healed each and every one of them, no matter the disease, simply by the touch of his hand. Many were possessed by demons, and the demons came out at his command, shouting, "You are the Son of God." But because they knew he was the Messiah, he rebuked them and refused to let them speak. Still more in the village were possessed by demons. And we may ask why there were so many demons then and why we see so few now. But I actually think we still see many now. So many looking to cause damage and perform acts of evil. That's the way I see it, at least. That we have no fewer demon possessions now than Jesus did in his world. In his time, I should say. But there's also the fact that during this time that we're reading about, there was no Holy Spirit dwelling inside the children of God to keep the demons from possessing them. And that's no small thing. Plus, one thing to remember, God is omnipresent. He is everywhere at all times. In all times. Satan and his demons, on the other hand, are not. As crafty and vile as they are, they can't be everywhere. See, God is all-powerful. Satan and his demons are only as powerful as God allows for his own purposes and to further his own plans. And once again, we see the Lord refuse to allow the demons to speak in front of crowds of people. But we get another piece of information here, that he wouldn't let them speak because those demons knew that he was the Messiah. Now, why wouldn't he let them speak then? Why not let them just proclaim and tell everyone that the Messiah had arrived? Now, it could very well have been because it wasn't his time yet. It wasn't time for Jesus to be recognized as the Messiah by the people. But I also think it has something to do with the fact that the gospel isn't meant to be spread through lying, deceitful lips of evil. That the good news of Christ is to come solely through those speaking the truth of his salvation in love and with a devotion to see the kingdom of God become as populated as possible. Because whatever comes out of the lips of liars is going to be doubted and distrusted. And that's something we need to think about ourselves. Are we keeping the words coming out of our mouths honest? Because if we don't, how will those we're trying to reach with the good news of salvation believe us about the enduring and perfect love of the Father? Early the next morning, Jesus went out to an isolated place. The crowd searched everywhere for him, and when they finally found him, they begged him not to leave them. Jesus always went out to an isolated place to pray, seek the face of and speak to the Father. No distractions, just him and the Father, as we should ourselves. But in this moment, the crowds of people from Capernaum caught up to him and found him. And when they did, they begged him not to leave, to stay in their village and become a healer and teacher for them alone, to be their personal miracle worker in a way. But he replied, "I must preach the good news of the kingdom of God to other towns too, because that is why I was sent." So he continued to travel around preaching in synagogues throughout Judea. In all the accounts of casting out demons and healing the blind and the sick and the lame, in all the excitement of the miracles, we can forget the true reason for Jesus' ministry. We can confuse the reason for his first coming, the victory over sin and death for mankind through the salvation of his blood, because he willingly laid down his life to pay the debt of mankind's sin, with the reason behind his ministry on earth. with the reason he traveled from town to town, village to village, city to city, instead of simply laying down his life immediately. And that reason is the fact that Jesus' ministry wasn't about healing or casting out demons. It wasn't about miracles at all. Jesus' ministry was a teaching ministry. Jesus' ministry was about letting everyone know about the coming kingdom of God. That was the goal of his ministry. The ministry that the disciples would inherit. The ministry that we inherited. The ministry to take the message of the good news to all the nations of the world so that all people have the opportunity to come to salvation in the risen Christ. Look, experiencing healing here on earth is incredible. Witnessing the miraculous is amazing. But there is only one miracle that truly matters, and that's the miracle of Christ rising out of the tomb and in so doing conquering death. Because people don't and won't place their trust in Christ because they witnessed a miracle. The Bible itself is full of examples of that. And all of his followers will one day be healed when we are glorified in heaven. Trust in Christ comes from faith. And faith comes from believing. And believing comes through hearing the word of God. Through being taught his word. So listen, learn, study, and teach. His earthly ministry is ours to carry out now. It was entrusted to us. So let's do those things. Listen, learn, study, and teach his word so we can carry out his ministry. How about we get up and move to a bonus song with Mr. Isaac?
You are the God who works wonders. You reveal your strength. You are the God who works wonders. You reveal your strength among the peoples. You are the God who works wonders. You reveal your strength.
So let's see how this week's lesson connects back to Christ. Jesus' miracles proved that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God. His miracles strengthened people's faith and met their needs. Through Jesus, God did what is impossible for us to do on our own. He provided forgiveness, salvation, and eternal life. So, for our final portion of Scripture, I want to return to the epistles, because as those entrusted with the ministry of Jesus, we should learn how we are to go forth in that mission to carry out his good news. So, let's take a look at James chapter 1, verses 19 through 27. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. Well, doesn't that describe the flaws of, well, all of us? We are all, just as a people and a species, slow to listen, quick to speak, and ready to become angry at a moment's notice. That's the sin nature of man, to center ourselves in all things, to make ourselves the center of attention, of importance, to make our emotions the most important in every moment, to make our ideas the ones that need to be heard no matter who's speaking, to simply be the one whom the entire universe revolves around. But that's not how it is. That's just the way our sinfulness tempts us to feel. The truth is, we aren't the center of all things. We aren't even the main characters of our own story. We're the supporting characters in Christ's story. So if we want to produce the righteousness God desires, that good fruit we can produce by abiding in Christ, we have to be like Christ. We have to follow him, be obedient to the way he told us to live. And part of that way is being quick to listen, always being a willing ear for those in pain and those whose hearts are heavy burdened with the stress of living in this fallen world. We all have stress and worries, and we would like someone to listen to us. So we need to be that person who listens for others. And we need to be slow to speak in these situations, because not everyone who is looking for us to listen is looking for us to give advice, to tell them what we think or what we do in their situation. Sometimes people just want someone to listen, not someone to solve all their problems. We also need to understand when it's our time to listen to someone else's ideas and teachings, and when it's our turn to express our ideas and opinions. And slow to anger. Yeah, this is the test of all tests. Because the ones we're supposed to be modeling Christ-like virtues for the most are our kids. And slow to anger, to be understanding and patient as a parent, it is torturous sometimes. It is so tough because we can see our kids walking in the traps, and we can anticipate the words that are about to come out of their mouths. But we need to model the patience of Christ and the enduring love and understanding of the Father for our kids. And we need to take our time to let them make some mistakes and then use that opportunity to show them how to learn from those mistakes to be a better child of God. These are three of the most difficult things for us humans to figure out. But they are what we have to figure out. And we need to be patient and understanding of each other as we work towards this goal of being Christ-like together. So get rid of all the filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word of God as planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. All right, so we're never going to get rid of our sinful natures. We're never going to rid ourselves of them. We cannot be sinless. The Sermon on the Mount by Jesus taught us that. We're actually going to learn that in a few months, probably. But while we can't tear the sinfulness out of us, in our sanctification, in our walk to be more like Christ, we can remove ourselves from the situations and environments and activities that tempt us to remain in our sin. Look, we are saved from our sinfulness by the grace of God, by his undeserved gift of salvation. But that doesn't mean we should abuse that gift by continuing to live in sin. We should be better because we should love the one who loved us first. We should be producing good fruit to show that we are truly abiding in Christ, not placing his perfect love to the test. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says, otherwise you are only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and don't obey, it is like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, walk away, and forget what you look like. Going to church, listening to sermons, watching Christian television programs, listening to Christian music, none of that makes someone a Christian any more than going to a ballpark, playing catch, watching every game of the season, and listening to sports talk radio or podcasts makes someone a baseball player. The only way we can truly know that we are abiding in Christ is if we're placing our trust and faith in him, and we are producing good fruit. If we're doing good in his name and for his glory, to enrich his kingdom. If we're always listening to Christ tell us to turn left, and we keep turning right, then we're fooling ourselves. And we need to reevaluate whether or not we are truly abiding in him. Because if he is truly our Lord, then we need to be his bondservants and obey his commands, his word, and do as he says, when he says. But if you look carefully into the perfect law that sets you free, and if you do what it says and don't forget what you heard, then God will bless you for doing it. All right, this isn't some false prosperity mumbo jumbo. This is simply that if we trust and abide in Christ, then he blesses us. If we rely on God for our provisions, he will provide. He will not send us into a trial that he has not equipped us for. After all, his blessings are abundant and for our good. So follow him with everything we have. That's what we're to do. Because while that path won't always be easy, it will always be blessed. If you claim to be righteous but don't control your tongue, you are fooling yourself and your religion is worthless. As we were speaking about with Jesus not allowing the demon to name him as the Messiah, the good news isn't spread by unclean lips, by lies and deceit. There are many false religions that are, but not the gospel. Notice James here doesn't say anything about salvation, though. James doesn't say that our salvation is worthless if we can't control our tongue, but our religion, our means of reaching out to those unsaved peoples of the world is worthless, is useless because if we can't control our tongue, we can't control the way we speak, then we'd have turned people away with our lies or our vulgarity, our foul language. And while we'd still have salvation in Christ, we wouldn't be carrying out the command of the Lord, the great command, the great commission, to take the gospel of eternal salvation into all the nations of the world and make disciples of all the nations to bring everyone the good news of the kingdom of God. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father means caring for orphans and widows in their distress and refusing to let the world corrupt you. Pure and genuine religion. We are to teach the world about the coming kingdom. But we can't do that if we refuse to walk in the footsteps of Christ. We can't effectively teach or preach the word of God if we can't act and behave in a way that shows Christ to those listening. No one is going to take to heart the teachings of Christ from a person who acts and behaves like the rest of the world that we are claiming is so sinful. We have a goal: to spread the seeds of the gospel everywhere we walk. It's not just a Sunday thing. It's not just a Wednesday thing. It's not just a nice, neat, prepared speech kind of thing. It's an everyday thing. It's an every minute thing. Because the fact is, we never know when the Lord is going to place us in the path of someone in desperate need of the gospel, in desperate need of someone willing to be understanding and patient, willing to listen and teach them about the truth of our world, the truth that life, this life that we are living, isn't all there is, the truth that there is a better place, a kingdom with a perfect king, a king of perfect justice and perfect love, and that the only path to that kingdom is narrow, is a narrow, narrow road that only allows those who've had their debt of sin forgiven to walk down it. Only those who've placed their trust in the one who paid their debt. Only those who placed their trust in Christ. So we need to make it known that the wide path of this corrupting world needs to be avoided. And we need to set ourselves apart from it, to be set apart for Him and for His kingdom. And we can't spread that message to those who need to hear it most if we're speaking it while still trying to keep one foot in that corrupted world. We need to show those searching for hope that following and abiding in Christ is the only thing that brings true joy. And we can only do that by walking out our Christian walk in joy ourselves and allowing ourselves to be a reflection of Him, by allowing ourselves to decrease and allowing Him to increase and increase abundantly in our lives. In the way that we present ourselves, in the way that we speak, in the way that we interact with others, and most with just the joy and love that we radiate and reflect out to all who come across us. So, how about we take a few moments to praise and worship that very Lord with Mr. Isaac.
Plans I have for you. This is the Lord's declaration. Plans for your well-being, not for disaster. To give you a future and a hope. To give you a future and a hope.
Now it's time to prep yourself for the Pastor Kevin Shuffle. To your ready positions. Are you set?
Hi there, I'm Pastor Kevin, it's time for questions from kids. Andre from Tacoma, Washington asks,
why does God perform miracles for some people and not others?
Andre, that is a really interesting question. Now, we believe that the Bible is true. In Isaiah chapter 46, and even in Psalms chapter 115, God tells us that he is in heaven and he does whatever he chooses. Here's a big word. The big word is sovereign, which means God is in absolute control and that he reigns and rules over everything. He either performs or does not perform miracles for his own glory. Yes, even if God does not perform a miracle, that is also for his glory. Andre, I want you to trust God because of the miracles he has already performed. We can see miracles and signs and wonders in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. And whether he performs miracles or not, he always gives us what we need. You can trust that everything God does is good for you. Why can you trust God to always provide you with exactly what you need?
So I hear from you in the comment section. Why can you always trust God to provide you with exactly what you need? And once again this week, I want to try something a little bit different. Instead of having a teacher's perspective, how about we take a look at a new video series I'm going to be beginning and get this answer to this question from me in the first episode of the Devos. Welcome to the Devos. Our question for this week is, why can you always trust God to provide you with exactly what you need? Now, to answer this question, I want to take a look at Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. And my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. This verse comes from the letter Paul was writing to the early Christian church in Philippi, and in this portion of the letter, Paul was commending the Philippians for their giving of money for the needy church in Jerusalem and for the continuation of Paul's own mission trips to spread the good news of Christ to all the world. Now, it wasn't that the church in Philippi was particularly wealthy. That wasn't the important part. That's not why he was writing the letter or commending them for how they helped out. It was that their giving was from the heart. Their giving meant something. And that's what's important when it comes to giving. That our giving means something. That our giving comes from a joyous heart. A heart that wants to share the joy that the Lord bestowed upon us. Share the blessings the Lord has poured out on us, no matter how meager those blessings may appear to the outside world. Because we can't outgive the Lord. We are giving out of a finite supply, a limited supply of whatever it is we've been blessed with. But see, the Lord is giving from his mighty abundance, from his limitless supply. So when we give generously from our meager budgets, the Lord blesses from his abundance. Now, we need to be careful not to take this verse the wrong way, though, because it's not saying that if we give, God will give, like some false doctrines say, claiming that by giving from our wealth, God will multiply it. It's not that. It's that we can give in confidence because God will provide for our needs. To not worry about earthly wealth because no amount of earthly wealth can give us what we truly need anyway. It may get us what we momentarily want, but never what we need. Because what we truly need is eternity in his presence. And that we will never be able to buy with our wealth. But luckily for us, that is something he offers up freely to all who believe, all who have faith, and all who trust in Jesus Christ. Thank you for sitting with me through the first episode of the Devos. I plan on uploading these every Saturday as a way to just answer these questions, keeping them short, sweet, and to the point. So please join me for them each and every week. And share the message around if you liked it. Have a great night, and I shall see you again next week. I hope everyone had a great time tonight, and let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much once again for allowing us to gather like this. Thank you so much, Lord, for a wonderful time tonight, for once again using me as a tool to spread your gospel. And Lord, please help us to take these lessons to heart, to reflect on the way that we act when we are out in public, the way that we speak, and the way that we present ourselves, so that way we can be aware of what we are reflecting when people see us, to be aware about whether or not we are reflecting the world or we're reflecting you. Because we really should look to reflect you. And please help us, Lord. Please fill us with the Spirit. Please continue to nag and remind us and nudge us to being reflections of you, to being reflections for all that see us, so that they don't see us because we are so diminished, but that they instead see you because you have increased so much in our lives. Lord, please help us go through this next week. Please bless us as we go through this next week. Please provide for us. And please, Lord, just help us to be more like you. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. And with that, blessings to everyone watching. And I hope to see you again next week for Tilling the Soil. As we lift up the praise, set our tongues ablaze, as we raise our hands, give a praise unto the Lord. Stand up and sing, we accept this offering. Worthy of a praise, Lord, and the King.